So apparently, chances are good that Starship SN8 will still hop this year. Who would have thought? Let's take a look at the latest developments at Boca Chica and try to come up with a realistic timeline for the next weeks. In other news, we want to talk about Rocket Lab again. They successfully launched 30 small satellites and recovered the booster in a reusability milestone.
Then Stratolaunch starts building a Mach 6 hypersonic plane. The DNA of Arthur C. Clarke will be brought to the moon with Astrobotic's Peregrine lander in 2021. And the famous Arecibo telescope will be decommissioned after it had been damaged in an accident. A lot to talk about, so stay tuned.
Surprisingly, it appears the Starship prototype SN8 will carry on its testing campaign quite undeterred from its latest static fire incident 2 weeks ago. The Raptor engine, which had been damaged on that fateful day, has now been replaced with a newer Raptor engine, the SN42. And Starship SN8 is currently set to begin the last round of static fire tests. This means that upon hopefully successful completion of the tests, the final preparations for that 15-kilometer hop are set to start. But should a new problem occur, we know that delays can happen very fast. Anyways, we think that a 15-kilometer test flight with SN8 will take place at some point in December.
Hopefully early December, but if it gets late December, then we will at least have a nice Christmas present. In order to make some nice recordings, the Starhopper got a camera installed to have a better vantage point to make some impressive shots of the liftoff and landing procedure. Apart from the preparations for the SN8 hop, SN9 is developing really nicely. The nose cone of SN9 has been finally stacked on top of the upper body section. Now this whole section only remains to be stacked onto the main body of SN9, which probably will happen by the end of the week or early next week. Here we can see the SN9 main body in its full glory, already with rear body flaps attached, waiting to receive the upper section with the nose cone. We can see that SN9 looks even smoother than SN8, because the welding process has been improved even more. And SN9 will be for the first time fully based on 304L stainless steel, since SN8 still had a few parts based on 301. SN9 will thus be an even more perfected version of SN8. Meanwhile, work is continuing at the launch site of the Super Heavy booster. We get a bit of an idea how this will look when completed from this already quite too overused CGI movie. It will be a quite compact and enclosed structure, so that we probably won't really see the 6 steel rods anymore. They will be encapsulated and surrounded by a steel concrete structure connected to a tower. We just wished Super Heavy construction would move forward a bit faster. We're waiting on more news on the Super Heavy, but somehow it's quite slow. Probably because all attention is now focused on the SN8 hop and of getting it right this time. Remember that without the Super Heavy booster, no moon, no Mars, not even orbit. So we need that thing, and it hopefully should be built fast. It will sport 28 Raptor engines. Imagine there will have to be testing campaigns for a booster with 28 Raptor engines, and we saw how much can go wrong with already 3 Raptor engines. So it is really imperative that work on the booster accelerates, and we hope that Elon will shift the focus more and more on the Super Heavy in the months following the SN8 hop.
And please subscribe to our YouTube channel, because that really helps us to make a difference. Almost all the other space channels on YouTube are too afraid to call out lobbyism and corruption in the spaceflight industry, but we are not. And with your support by subscribing to us and liking our videos, we could make a real difference together. Thank you very much. Then let's talk about a very interesting spaceflight company, which we didn't mention so often yet on this channel, Rocket Lab. Rocket Lab is a company which was founded 14 years ago in New Zealand, and since has moved its headquarters to California. So it's a quite unique US-New Zealandish mix in the rocket industry. They are highly interesting because they have a very capable rocket system with their Electron rocket. This is a small reusable rocket designed to carry light payloads to low Earth orbit. So contrary to some BS media articles, it is not really a competitor to SpaceX, as it is addressing a quite different customer base. The LEO payload capacity of the Electron is around 300 kilograms. Since the rocket is so much smaller than the Falcon 9, it cannot do propulsive landing. Instead, the Electron has a parachute, which opens once the rocket has been decelerated enough by Earth's atmosphere. And then it splashes down into the ocean and can be recovered. Or, as in this case, the rocket can also be recovered in mid-air, which is quite spectacular to look at. So in the latest launch from the 19th of November, the rocket lifted off from New Zealand, carrying 30 small spacecraft to low Earth orbit. Among those were 25 small Space B satellites from the company Swarm Technologies, which is assembling a constellation of 150 such small Space Bs that will provide communication services to Internet of Things devices around the world. Then another two satellites are going to test long tethers to deorbit space debris efficiently, an idea which we really like. The company behind it is the Virginia-based Tricept Corp. A 3D printed gnome was also sent along with the rocket, which people familiar with the Half-Life series might recognize.
Oh, and they want to be the first ones sending a private mission to the awesome planet Venus, because Rocket Lab founder and CEO Peter Beck really likes Venus. We completely sympathize with him because we were also always saying that Venus is getting too little love. But now, with the discovery of phosphine gas in the upper atmosphere of Venus, which could be due to the presence of microbial life, this is probably bound to change. Rocket Lab wants to send a small probe to Venus called Photon, which will deploy a few smaller probes into Venus's atmosphere. These small probes will collect lots of data and hopefully help us answer the question if there is indeed microbial life in the upper atmosphere of that amazing hellhole of a planet.
Also an interesting company is Stratolaunch, the guys who are building the world's largest plane, which is designed to launch small rockets directly from altitudes higher than passenger plane flights. Stratolaunch is now building their Talon hypersonic plane, which is planned to reach speeds of Mach 6, so 6 times the speed of sound. The Talon A will be reusable and launched from the before-mentioned Stratolaunch plane. But don't get your hopes up for traveling with the Talon, because it's not intended to fly humans. In their own words, our hypersonic testbeds will serve as a catalyst in sparking a renaissance in hypersonic technologies for our government, the commercial sector, and academia. So first, probably only military or science applications. And then maybe one day in the far future, we could see hypersonic passenger airplanes arise from this. But then again, by then we will have Starship Earth to Earth, which will be even faster. So we think that hypersonic planes might never really take off. Yet still, this is a really cool development, and we will certainly keep an eye on it.
In other news, one of the payloads that the Peregrine lander will deploy to the surface of the moon, when it will land there sometime next year, is the DNA of famous science fiction writer Arthur C. Clarke. Most of you certainly have heard about the movie 2001: A Space Odyssey, or have even seen it. It is one of the all-time classics of sci-fi cinema, and the movie is based on his book with the same name. How fitting that some of his ashes are brought to the moon, since the moon plays a central role in the 2001 novel. Arthur C. Clarke wrote the novel back in 1968, so it depicts a moon base at Clavius Crater in the year 2001, and depicts regular trips to the moon as being very common in that time. This was really realistic back in 1968, when gigantic advances were made every year, and the moon landings were only a year away. But unfortunately, we know what happened afterwards, namely nothing. The US abandoned the moon and began a long and brutal decline in spaceflight capability, which is only now being restored by Elon Musk and his awesome company SpaceX. Only now, 19 years after 2001, we are seriously seeing some progress in spaceflight again, so that maybe by 2030 we indeed might have a moon base thanks again to SpaceX. But at least some parts of Arthur C. Clarke will be around on the moon to witness the new SpaceX moon base. How awesome is that?
In more sad news, the famous Arecibo radio telescope will be decommissioned after it was damaged in a cable rupture accident on August 10th this year. The exact cause of the accident is still unknown. It was not a storm or some natural catastrophe. It just ruptured. The Arecibo telescope is a real icon of radio astronomy and was built from 1960 to 1963. It had its first light on November 1st, 1963. So the Arecibo telescope made observations for 57 years. With a diameter of 304.8 meters, it was the largest radio telescope for a long time, until it had recently been surpassed by the Chinese 500-meter aperture spherical telescope, FAST. This image here shows how much larger the FAST telescope is compared to the Arecibo one. Arecibo got famous also because of its use for the SETI project. It had collected lots of radio data for the SETI at Home project, which was also used for the SETI Institute's Project Phoenix observations. Project Phoenix had the goal to search for extraterrestrial intelligence by analyzing patterns in radio signals. Rather than attempting to scan the whole sky for messages, the project concentrated on nearby systems that are similar to our own.
Project Phoenix's targets comprised about 800 stars within a 200 light-year range. The project searched for radio signals as narrow as 1 Hz, between 1 and 3 GHz, a quite broad bandwidth compared with most SETI searches. In March 2004, the project announced that after checking the 800 stars on its list, it had failed to find any evidence of extraterrestrial signals. We are, by the way, absolutely not surprised that they supposedly didn't find any signals. We have two very old videos talking about that topic, and we would need to make a new full video explaining why they didn't find any signals. But there are two really excellent talks by Jim Benford, we put the links to both in the description, explaining why the current SETI search strategy might be absolutely wrong and why we might have been looking the wrong way all the time. So it's no wonder then that the cosmic neighborhood appears to be silent. But it's still sad to see such an icon of SETI search go. Arecibo telescope, you will be missed.
We want to say thank you to everyone who watched our live stream from yesterday.
Yes, it was amazing and we had a lot of fun discussing with you and answering the questions.
And we will certainly do another live stream in December. So be sure to check out our channel homepage from time to time.
So thanks as always for watching the JS Space Report, and then I would say, on to the future.
Looking good. Everything looking good?
Yeah.
Okay, then probably we'll be freaked out. Scheiße.
I see.
What do you prefer?
I don't mind.
Language.